am the desire of my heart indeed, and my prayer to God is for their salvation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. 25 years is not a long time, relatively speaking. These years we've been commemorating the centennial of World War I. That's a little longer of time, and none of us are alive who were active in those years. But 25 years is a chunk of time in our lives that we can experience and still have memories of. I'm sure that almost all of us can remember 1993, 94, 95, the early 90s. When we say it's a quarter of a century, it sounds like a long time. When we talk about 1996, it was yesterday. And this is precisely what's happening for St. Paul in this letter to the Romans. So as I mentioned to you last week in the bulletins, for this next coming year, since tomorrow will be the day that I arrived here in the midst of all of your pain and suffering 12 months ago. It hasn't been 12 months. You have survived me, we've made it, and so this is good. But it also means that now for the next 12 months we're going to do the epistles. And that first reading, the word that we use, epistle, is just English taken directly from the Latin epistola, which means a letter, something sent. That's all that it means. So these are the letters primarily of St. Paul, but they will be of the other apostles also. And this epistle to the Romans, today it's taken from the first part, most of chapter 10. St. Paul is answering a question to the Romans, who, for the most part, that church is going to be people who come from a pagan background to Christianity. And of course, at this point, 25 years after our Lord's ascension, because this letter is written probably about the year 58, St. Paul is probably in his late 50s. And the Gentiles, the pagans who are now Christians, of course, in Rome, they're wondering, because it seems kind of a predicament, that if the Messiah was sent to Israel, and Israel was to be God's nation inheritance to spread the gospel of the Messiah, then at this point, 25 years later, why hasn't Israel as a nation converted? There have been thousands and thousands of Jews who have embraced the gospel. But Israel as a recognizable corporate, national, ethnic body seems at this point, at the end of a quarter of a century, to have rejected the Messiah. How can this be possible? So I encourage you to read chapter 9, chapter 10, and chapter 11 of St. Paul, because all we're doing today is this quotation from the middle of it. Chapter 11 gives you the large vision of history, of Israel and of the Gentile nations. And when we say Gentiles, that's also just taken directly from the Latin. Gentes, the word gentes, gentiles, the gentes just means the nations. So you have Israel, who stands out distinct among the nations because God has formed them over the period of 15 centuries, precisely for the coming of the Christ. And so these people in Rome are wondering, if God has spent 1,500 years through the Torah, through Moses on Mount Sinai, through the Psalms, through the prophets, if he has spent all of this time, which we have in the Gospel of our Lord, opening the minds of the apostles to understand these scriptures, if God has spent that much time for 15 centuries, how is it that they don't get it? Now, we can talk about Israel at some point, we will, specifically on why they don't accept. But St. Paul is talking about this in a larger scene. He does talk about why they haven't accepted, but he talks about a larger kind of plan of salvation that we talk about. And that's why the epistle today that you have typed out in your bulletin begins with a strange line, which just simply says, "Brethren, the desire of my heart, indeed my prayer to God always, is for their salvation. The they is Israel. That's what's beginning this quotation as we have it today. And what the letter to the Romans overall is about is St. Paul contrasting human effort and Christ, who is the perfection of God. People trying to do things and to find a wholeness, a salvatio, a salvation on their own, which of course they can't do. We fall on our faces. But that does have an impact about how Israel is regarding the law. So if you look at the very last lines of chapter 9, St. Paul at that point already quotes, because he's talking about the exclusion of Israel from the gospel. How is it that they make this choice not to embrace the gospel? And he says it's their fault, and they are guilty. He doesn't cover that over. And he will deal with that question of guilt and falling more in chapter 11. But that lack of embracing the gospel, he begins actually, the quotations probably should have begun two lines earlier, because he's quoting from the prophet Isaiah in the Old Testament. Behold, I lay a stone in Zion, which will be a stumbling block, which will make men stumble. It's a stone of scandal. And he's using it referring to the Messiah, using this prophecy from 8 centuries before from the great prophet Isaiah. And he's saying this is already announced, that Israel is already going to trip over the Messiah. Now when he begins to speak about this exclusion from Israel, he then says, what should we say then? Israel, by following the law of righteousness, has not arrived at the law of righteousness. It's to understand what the law was meant to be. At the time of Adam and Eve, the creation of the human race, of which from whom we are all descended, we are wounded people. We are a wounded race of mankind. We are wounded people. And hence that contrast of human perfection and the perfection which is given by God. But what God does thousands of years after creation is he takes a people through Abraham, and then through Abraham's descendants, through Isaac, through Jacob, Jacob's name was changed to Israel, and through those sons of Israel, that clan of about 70 people at that point, all the families together, they all go trundling down to Egypt, where ultimately God's providence beats them into a people through enslavement over at least a century or two at the end of their 450 years that they stayed in Egypt. And then, of course, you know the Exodus and all the rest of this. He melds them together and brings them to Mount Sinai to begin to teach them. And the fundamental words of Mount Sinai are the natural law. Don't kill. Don't lie. Be faithful in your marriage. Honor God and the rest of it. They're what the Jews call the 10 words. We call them the commandments, but the terminology is actually the words, the 10 words, which is why we have the word Decalogue. Logos is word, Deca is 10, just from the Greek. Decalogue just means 10 words. And what St. Paul is saying is that they're being taught to form a people so that there is at least somewhere on the face of the earth that I can send my anointed, the Christ, to be received. That is the purpose of all of this Mount Sinai and everything else, and all of the prophets and the Psalms and everything, all the inspired scriptures. So what he says by this phrase in verse 30 of chapter 9, what should we say? That Israel, by seeking after the law of justice, does not arrive at the law of justice, this paradise. Because Israel sought justice, sought righteousness, but in observant works, what you do, what you can't do, whether you can cook on the Sabbath, whether you can turn on lights or not turn on lights. So having worked in New York for 2 years, you get a big introduction to Judaic culture. And I had parishioners in New York who said, oh yeah, Father, I was a Shabbat boy. And it's a Shabbat boy. Shabbat boy was in Brooklyn when we had our neighbors over there, because they all, I was good, I left after 2 years or else this accent would have stuck. And he says, yeah, so we were in the neighborhood and we had all these Jews who were around, and of course they don't turn on the lights for the Shabbat. So the Shabbat boy was the 12-year-old boy you gave 50 cents to, or a buck, or whatever, depending upon the year. And he would come over in the morning and turn the lights on for you in your apartment, and then come back with anything else you needed to turn on or off. He was a Shabbat. The goy refers to the non-Israelite, the other, the pagan. So he was Shabbat goy. And so, by the observant works, how much you can lift on the Sabbath, how much you can carry, can you practice medicine? You see it in the Gospels. Can you do this? Can you not do this? By these observant works, which are from the law of Moses, these things are not, they're in large part interpretations, but they are there in the law of Moses. That what St. Paul is saying, that by these observant works, that Christ, who demanded faith to receive the word, to hear, to listen, and to personally react, not as a corporate body, but as an individual person, that they found unacceptable. Turning on lights or turning off lights, that's one thing. You either do it or you don't do it. But the idea of me being personally faithful, and through that fidelity, the transformation of my existence, give us something easier. Tell me I can't lift more than 2 pounds on Saturday. I can do that. But to tell me that I have to be personally loyal because I hear the word, that engages too much of me. It's like all of the dozens of our families who don't come here. But because genetically they're linked to faithful Maronites in the past, that somehow salvation is going to happen for them. It's not. What the Jews found unacceptable was the fact that our Lord said, you must believe, you must embrace the word that you hear. It's not through works, it's not through biology, it's not through genetics, it's not through culture, it's not through heritage, it's through you personally engaging yourself to this word. That's the meaning of today's epistle. St. Paul is saying, because they had spent 15 centuries, get this roll right, don't get that roll right, don't mix meat with milk, don't cook that here, make sure this is washed, make sure that's not polluted. And then we mentioned in the parable of the Good Samaritan, the Levite and the priest who walk around the man dying on the side of the road. They do exactly what the law of Moses tells them to do. You can't be in contact with a dead body. It makes you polluted. And the Levites were explicitly told they had nothing to do with the dead because they would be unfit for the altar. But to do things from that point of view is easy. Once you get it done, you get it done. It becomes a habit. And St. Paul says they fell through their own faults because they rejected this aspect of faith, because it's hard. And therefore he makes the statement that Israel, by following the law of righteousness, have not attained to the law of righteousness, because that righteousness truly only comes from the Christ. This is the scandal. This is what's making them trip up. And that's why then St. Paul says that the end of the law is Christ. The whole purpose of Mount Sinai was to prepare a people to receive the Messiah. And in that they have failed. And while they keep running after to try to do these activities, they do not find the righteous righteousness that God has promised through grace and through their faith. And when he says that the end of the law is Christ, it has the same double meaning as in English. An end can be a purpose, the end for which we're working. And an end can also mean the thing is stopped. And he means that ambiguity purposely there, because the Christ is the purpose of why the law was present. And with the coming of the Christ, the law is stopped. Not destroyed, but by perfecting it in Christ, you elevate it to perfection. The Sermon on the Mount, you've heard it said to the ancients, thou shalt not kill. But I say to you, you will not even be angry and hold a grudge with your brother, except that you will be guilty and susceptible to the fires of Gehenna. Well, obviously, if you're moved that farther away that you can't even have anger and hatred, grudge in your heart, you're much that further removed from murdering a person. He elevates it by perfection, the end. So for us to kind of bring it all together for today, that in this chapter what St. Paul is saying is that in quoting Deuteronomy, who can go up to Christ, who can go down to Christ, read the epistle again, it's a little unusual phrase. What can you do by mounting to heaven? You can't bring Christ down. By going down below, you can't bring Christ up. He's giving an interpretative quotation from Deuteronomy chapter 30. But what he's saying is your works do not make Christ present. Your works and what you do, whether you lift 2 pounds or don't lift 2 pounds on the Sabbath, will not make righteousness appear in your life. And so that's that strange quotation. If you read it again, you'll see. So that the point of what St. Paul is bringing together in this section of his letter is that both the Jews and the Gentiles were in the minority before the coming of Christ. The maturity of God, what God desires in his creation, comes in the person of his divine Son. So that the Gentiles who were left to their own wits, their reason, their thinking, who accomplished a lot of great things, philosophy, political ideas, empires, culture, art, they did a lot of beautiful things, and they worshiped idols. Israel, that he tries to take out of that whole morass, and to teach them and form them and prepare them, they're also in their minority, but they're being tutored. You know the word tutor, again from the Latin, tutus means to keep safe. A tutor is not a teacher, a tutor is someone who supervises a child. The same thing with a pedagogue. St. Paul will talk about this also, that the law was a pedagogue. A pedagogue, we talk about pedagogical tech methods. Hey. Because it comes from the Greek word paidos, which means boy. But the pedagogue in the classical world, when St. Paul writes this, the pedagogue wasn't a teacher. The pedagogue was the slave who took care of this boy to take him to the teachers, to make sure he wasn't molested in the streets by the other kind of perverted Greeks. A very simple culture, all right? We gotta have somebody make sure to watch the kids on the way to school and back. We kind of are coming back to that pagan way of living culturally. So the pedagogue didn't teach, regardless of what pedagogical method means these days. The pedagogue led you to the teacher, and St. Paul says that the law of Moses was a pedagogue. The people of Israel were in their minority, like the pagans were in the minority, and with the coming of Christ, we are offered the maturity within God. If we hear that word, and if we respond individually and personally, within that response, we shall find healing and salvation. If we do not respond to the word, then we do not find that salvation and that healing. But it is to bring all into single work of salvation of the maturity of God, in which he finishes with those last lines of his epistle today, that everyone is to be brought into the one work of God's divine mercy through the death and resurrection of his Son. And that oneness means that there is no longer any distinction between Jew and Greek. Everyone is just people. It's not Gentiles and Israel, followers of the law and pagans. There is one reality. You either believe or you do not believe. You will either be part of that one work of redemption in the body of Christ, or you will be left outside in the woundedness of human nature trying to work itself out. That is the choice that St. Paul brings into, so that there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the Lord is the same over all, rich unto all those who call upon him. So we render thanks to God today through the Mother of God for having not only given us the ability that in our lives the Word has come, but for at least till this moment, because we're in these pews today, that he has also given us the grace and the strength to respond to that word personally, and in responding, to be able to drink from that richness of our Lord and to find the righteousness which comes only by the gift of grace in our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.